Today, my name is Mubarak Mugabo. Now, we today, 10th of July, 2020, 10 years ago, there was a bomb blast, and of course, the Lugogo bombings, where we lost many people from the suspected Al-Shabaab terrorists that hit us badly when Ugandans were watching the World Cup finals held at the 2010 World Cup finals in South Africa. Now, this is today marks 10 years, exactly 10 years since this very disturbing incident happened. And since then, government of Uganda instituted different measures to make sure that we shall never have this experience again in our history. Now, we will be discussing so many issues other than that, including the parliamentary approval of the election roadmap and also creation of the elderly posts in parliament, elderly slots in parliament by cabinet, and also later on we'll be discussing the education institutions guidelines issued by the Minister of Health and the Ministry of Education if candidate classes are to be reopened. Now, to discuss all these issues on this Friday panel are three people on the on this panel, and of course it's Tony Geoffrey Owana, a veteran journalist here with Vision Group. Very good morning and welcome to the show.
Be blessed.
Lynn Komjisha was still with him, and of course my co-host, and Nicholas Wasaja, parliamentary journalist with Vision, or which Tiwa, Nicholas Wasaja, not veterinary journalist,
this one is
senior journalist and also parliamentary reporter. Welcome to the show.
Description.
Now, gentlemen and lady, I must say that I'm really honored and privileged to have you this Friday, and always happy to
first
have the three of you
represent
us. I thought you never knew it.
Is Owana going to represent
the elder in the parliament? Whether no, Owana is either, are you elder or elderly? We shall reach to that element.
I am someone's elder. I am also elderly.
Let me start with you, Nicholas, actually, on the issue of the 2010 bombing in Lugogo. It's a very sad story, but what exactly do you say about that? And what is the comment you're making? Because after that time, we have never had any other attack that is happening in this country. Is it a success of government that we should also praise government and say we have really done what it takes to make sure that we do not have this attack anymore, or another intervention is still required to make sure that we deal with terror acts here in Uganda?
Thank you, Mubarak. One is, you remember that after those bombings, one of the things that has been happening is that, yes, if you're talking about success, it is true, security and government have made progress, because since then they have been able to thwart about 15 terror attacks in Uganda, including recently, about just last week, there is a terror cell that was busted in PG, and then you remember those bombings, that petrol bombs that were targeting government cars, and then there is also another terror cell that was thwarted. There's suspicion that people wanted to attack during the lockdown, but on the other hand, or on the flip side, you would say that from those terror bombings, there was an increase in organized crime. That is when we saw a spike in murdering of assassination of high profiles and Muslim clerics. Mm. But by and large, since one of the things that I think happened was the admission of government. You remember when the president clearly came out to say, if there is someone that feels they have an issue with this government, they should come out openly. I think that was initially injury. The problem yes. was that a government had refused to admit that there was an enemy, either from within or from outside. But the moment that he admitted that means that was a proper diagnosis of the problem, thus finding a proper solution to the problem. And since then, you've seen a bit of decline. We don't know whether there has been a bit of decline in organized crime, especially murders.
Before I come to Lynn, Tony Geoffrey Wana, is it actually a 10-year relief that we have not been so much hit as it used to happen in Kenya, the Westgate issues, and also other, you know, terror attacks that have been inflicted on Kenya? Is it actually that our government has really put up measures that are really arresting the situation and has been failed maybe in Kenya?
I am privileged to have worked very closely with some of the senior spies of this country, because that's the name you give them, spies. But they are usually intelligence gatherers. One of the marks goes to ordinary people and their vigilance.
Yes.
In identifying what is that?
Mm.
Which is absent in many other countries, including neighboring countries.
Mm.
People just don't care.
Yes.
But the level of vigilance in Uganda was and remains one of the successes.
Yes.
Even the president says it now about local councils in connection with the way people sneak in from outside with the COVID.
Yes.
He says those Bukiko are doing a wonderful job.
Mm.
That is one. Two, this country is not keen on releasing declassifying information.
Mm.
If the intelligence community would tell us what they have done over the years, you would have here information held in what you call a bank for the next 10 years. But they remain secretly hiding things which are no longer of
relevance.
No, they are relevant, but they are no longer secrets. But they don't say anything. So we sit here and speculate and what people are having, they don't give it. But let me say it straight away. One of the problems we got and which has persisted is with Islam. And I'm lucky.
The confusion.
You said one of the problems. Are you saying?
Is it a problem? Is it a problem to be Muslim?
I have to now at the correct temple.
Is it a problem to subscribe to the Islamic faith?
And
is there any connection?
You are now at
I don't
the
know if
you're temple.
Is there a connection between the bombing and the Islamic faith?
When James Mugira was still at CMI, CMI interrogated those three young people on camera. I think I'm the only one who might have a copy in the journalism comment. I think others have lost it.
We are going to come for it.
Carefully. But what I'm bringing up is this. Up to now, the media still writes of people who are arrested as
Muslim clerics and Muslims. Yes.
You are a Catholic? Are you?
I'm not.
He's not so sure.
Whatever you
do. He's not so sure.
He's there. I'm a believer.
Yes. I never hear.
Hey, I've never heard of HT not
Catholics arrested or Protestants arrested. But whenever a Muslim
the religion has
is
been
arrested,
profiled.
No, there is that kind of connection. I would call it ignorance.
It's not a connection. It is a deliberate profiling of a particular religion, and I think that is what Tony is trying to bring out.
And this has
gone on for a long time. We have seen these cases world over.
Mm.
Whatever terrorist action happens, it is of course attached to the Muslims.
Exactly, because
and over time we have seen this grow into
this is what I am saying, that it is either ignorance or a mindset that whichever act that is done by a Muslim, it's a terror act, and whichever wrong that is done by a Christian is just a minor
near
or a near just like the way you saw the New Zealand shootings. The West was classifying it as just a shooting.
Yeah.
But if it was a Mubarak behind it, it would have constituted a terror attack. On the people. Yeah. But of course...
So what does that say about us?
One time the defense minister of India was saying that we don't say that Muslim are terrorists, but we say all terrorists are...
Lynn, what do you have to say about... We may not go so much into detail of that.
Yes.
We had... an incident which people have forgotten in Ruseruka. Now, during the body count, almost all of the dead bodies were circumcised.
Oh. But circumcision is different from Islam.
what I'm underlining is that the media is generally to blame for this tagging.
Yes.
Absolutely.
We should just look at an offender.
I agree.
Not only the media, but the entire public.
You see, Tony, yes, the media, because the media sets the agenda. But now, for example, I'll give you the example of, we pick from our sources. For example, when the president says scientific wedding, and then the electoral commission comes out and says scientific
elections. Yes.
It is not the correct word, you get it, but we pick it on as a verb to
because
they have the
similar
characteristics. Now, you had a security chief that time and again characterized all attacks and criminality
to Islam
and fitted them into Islam.
Exactly. These are issues.
Even beyond the raids on Tony and Nicholas, we all know
that ADF, the Allied Democratic Force, the Democratic Forces.
But there are even cases where.
We all know that
they
are Muslims.
Gentlemen,
come back. I am the one in charge of this discussion.
Yes, sir.
And let me try to be in charge of discussion. I know I'm a Muslim and I may not have like Nicholas.
But we
all know that Allied Democratic Forces, commanded by Jamiru Mukulu, who is now in prison, is more or less a Muslim, dominated force. Mm-hmm. And we cannot, separate that from it. But that will be a discussion of it another day. I want to pick your, view, Aline, when it comes to the issue of the time from 2010 to now. The relief that we have had, we have not had attacks just like our neighbors, Kenya and Somalia, have had. Is this a sign of a competent security system that we have as a country to control and also prevent terror attacks?
I think since that time we have grown to that point. It's opened our eyes to what terrorism looks like,
mm-hmm.
to what extent we ought to change our security, our vigilance, and of course improve our terror monitoring.
Mm.
I'm not saying we are any better from our country. Of course, from our neighbors, yes, we are better, but we are still not easily accessible like they are. They are exposed.
Yes.
We are somewhat enclosed in there. But we have learned during this period. We have learned and we have put in place different systems. And I think the government has really done its part. They are always investing in the military. They're investing in security of the country, securing our borders. And it really paints a picture of how far we have come and how much the government has invested in our security and continues to invest, because we don't see many of these cases anymore.
Lynn seemed to suggest that actually our forces could be better than maybe the Kenyan forces, or we are just a distance.
I'm saying they are.
Tony, Ugandan security forces are forced to report.
Why do you
think
they're everywhere?
Let me tell you, when the Kenyans had that election of 2007, and they started on each other, the army maintained strict neutrality. by staying in barracks and watching.
And then what?
Okay,
what?
That they are neutral.
Yeah.
Even when people are finishing each other. But what am I saying? One of the things we did was to go to Somalia.
To detect the problem from
and
there.
Take it from it. That's what America does.
Mm.
They make sure the war is not on their continent. They pursue you where are you at.
Nicholas, do you agree that that could have played a part in, you know, putting Al-Shabaab busy the other side and not from here?
I think Uganda had gone, one of the reasons that the Al-Shabaab claimed the attack, that July
the Lugogo attack
was that because
the deployment
had invaded, had invaded
Somalia.
So by and large, there is a connection.
Mm.
But as a rejoiner to what Senior Wana was saying about community vigilance, my thinking is one of the things, yes, it is true, it is vigilant, and that vigilance is very important. And the president has time and again highlighted that during the Bush War, one of the strategies was to be close to the people because they have the information. But now, one of the challenges that is arising is the question of trust.
Mm.
If you see the way forces, for example, the LDU group behaves, if you see what the levels of corruption and how police behaves, interacts with the community, that is going to break the trust. And
yes.
If it does break the trust, that means there's not going to be cooperation between security forces and the communities. And then that intelligence, that the most vital component of security, which is intelligence gathering, is broken down. And then that lapses into insecurity. And that has a reflection on
the next 10 years.
The sitting government, because at its main pillar is maintaining peace and security, which everyone is proud of. But when that goes away, then you will have to start punching holes in.
Nicholas, Lynn, and Owen, I'm happy that actually you all agree that there has been some success registered, especially in mitigated, in mitigating and also making sure that we do not experience a similar circumstance and also the similar incident that happened 10 years ago. And we pray that, you know, the security forces and also the government should come up clearly to make sure that it strengthens the system so that we can as well live peacefully also in the next 10 years. And we see, we mark 20 years without any similar incident that claimed many lives of Ugandans, Ethiopians, and also others who were involved in that, you know, event. Now, this week, also, the Electoral Commission is insisting that the roadmap that it issued earlier on must be followed to make sure that they deliver a free, fair, and a just election. Now, last week, there was submissions from different stakeholders to the Legal and Parliamentary Affairs Committee, where members of parliament were hearing recommendations and also some proposals from the different stakeholders in how and also in the manner, in regard to the manner in which the 2021 election is going to be held. Now, yesterday, Parliament concluded with a report from the Committee of Legal and Parliamentary Affairs Committee approving the conduct of the 2021 Aegean elections. But also, some opposition members came up with the minority report objecting the mainstream report of the committee to say that elections are fit to be conducted. Also, in the similar line, Cabinet approved 5 slots for elderly people in Parliament. Now, recently, government also created 15 new counties, which are also going to be represented in Parliament. Parliament has had close to 500 MPs, but with the new creation of different, you know, seats may make Parliament getting more numbers than actually expected. Now, what we want to find out, those are two different issues, but I want to pick each and every one comment on, first of all, the clearance of the roadmap, Parliament giving a green light to the Electoral Commission to say, yes, go ahead and organize an election. Looking at what happened in that committee, Nicholas, let me start with you. Is there actually, was it a just, conclusion from the Legal and Parliamentary Affairs Committee to say, we have given you a green light, go ahead and, organize an election?
Maybe Mubarak, to contextualize a bit, the Legal and Parliamentary Affairs Committee has been dealing with two reports or has been dealing with two issues. What was approved yesterday was political parties and organizations regulations in conducting meetings. And these draft regulations were presented by the Minister for Justice and Constitutional Affairs, Ephraim Kamuntu. And they are anchored in the Political Parties and Organizations Act of the Political Parties and Organizations Act of 2006. The electoral roadmap, the Legal and Parliamentary Affairs Committee is also considering the electoral roadmap, and the Electoral Commission has made submissions and other stakeholders, but that is subject for debate next week. So what was approved yesterday was
the regulations tabled by the Minister of Constitutional Affairs.
By the Minister of Constitutional Affairs. And basically it is two major things that the Ministry of Justice or government is saying, is that what they call the POA, PPOA, Political Parties and Organizations Act, under clause, I think it is 27, gives the minister powers to draft regulations, you get it, within which political parties are supposed to conduct themselves when going for an election. Now, the minister, using that section, in consideration with the Healthy Act, which set guidelines to follow during to combat COVID-19,
yes,
the COVID-19 pandemic, set regulations. And there are basically eight pillars saying that you have these alternatives if you're supposed to organize meetings and organize primary elections and pick your leaders in preparation.
With the way you're seeing how this committee has handled the matter, are we seeing... do you really agree with the manner in which they handled it and the green light they given to the stakeholders to go out and say the elections, we are fit to organize an election?
Well, in all fairness, the committee followed the rules, and all it did was interact with stakeholders, you get it, political parties, majorly political parties that have a representation in parliament, and then the Electoral Commission, and then the government, the Ministry of Justice, and then agreeing with, but then deciding to approve the draft regulations as they were brought by the Minister of Justice. Yes, political parties on the opposition are making two arguments. They are saying that, one, under the Constitution, Article 71 and 72, that the minister, in as much as they have the mandate to set regulations, you get it, those regulations do not spill over to the management, internal management of party activities in political parties. And two, that if government oversteps its mandate, then that does not constitute what is enshrined in the Constitution, which is the democratic principles, that these political parties should adhere to the democratic principles.
I'll come back to you, Nicholas. Let me come to you, Geoffrey Owana. Did you see a spirit of the country first in approving these regulations?
Let me say it right away. I don't think the future of this country depends on the conduct of elections or on having an election at all costs. Okay?
Or not.
All this discussion we are having presupposes that at a certain date, do you remember why it took, most of you were suckling, I think you were babies, why it took? There was a rumor that on that day, the year 2002, up like this, all computers will collapse.
Yes.
Do you know how many people were cheated that I can adjust for your computer? That people lost a lot of money in lies. Now, I'm seeing that because the law says this, we must ignore certain realities on the ground and follow the law. And somehow, in case we break it, let us suffer. Okay? I've told you earlier, we spent 15 years with LOCs whose mandate had expired. Electoral mandate.
Yes.
But not whose responsibility to the community had expired.
Because yes,
that one doesn't expire.
Mm.
Okay? We continued for that time.
Then for 15 years.
For 15 years. We were undemocratic, I think, because we weren't voting.
Mm.
But as far as administration of the villages at the lowest level was concerned, there was some government. So here we are discussing the presence of a disease and somehow hoping that we can either ignore it.
Mm-hmm.
I want to thank New Vision for an editorial they issued. I'm forgetting the day. They are saying, don't conduct an election solely based on conforming to the rules of the guidelines on COVID-19.
Mm.
Because it's becoming now as if one of the main issues is the disease.
Yes.
The extreme is to ignore the disease. The Chief Justice, the former Chief Justice, when
you interviewed him,
he put it this way. He said, not in those words, he said it would be absurd to think that because rallying is our right, the disease will ignore us for some time until our right has been exercised, then maybe come back later. What am I saying? We are going to have an abnormal election.
And we expect normal results.
Some people do. Some people do, but I'm not one of those. For me, I'm looking at the objective. What is our objective? Is to get a next elected government.
Mm.
What is disturbing us is the methodology.
Yes.
For me, any political party that can't, in a situation of emergency, which does not know its best candidate at New Vision, does not deserve.
And yet, why are they wasting the time in the process which some of us know?
Because the law says so. They are now sticking to the law which is not working for the reality.
And at some point they say that we know the winner at the end of the day.
For example, you to moderate this program, was there an election? People sat somewhere and saying, Mubarak.
This one wants to zap my powers. Can we have actually a fair and just election, given the manner in which these issues are handled.
Can you enlighten us on what you mean by fair and
fair
just?
What he's trying to say is that it's not acceptable.
Mm.
The only election that the Constitution of Uganda envisions is a regular, free and fair election.
Mm.
And at the core of this argument is that we are simply organizing for a regular election. Free and fair is not there. But
free
these
and
are like you normally say,
because
these are three cooking stones.
Mm.
The absence of one means that you're not going to cook.
Lynn, when you look at the contents, actually, of some of these regulations, including the provision of having
hand picking.
This is not so strange to the NRM. It could have been the practice. But I mean, is it actually this?
It is not only the NRM work. We have seen these parties over time actually come together and say, okay, so Mubarak is going to be our, you know, flag bearer, and we expect all of you to support.
Just like what happened to Muntu's party. And
I don't know why suddenly it has become an issue of contention. They have been doing these things internally in their parties, and we have seen them go on. Why suddenly with the regulations they seem to want to play the things have not been happening the same way?
You ask Honorable Cecilia Ogwa why she did not contest the 1980 election.
And
her party sat and said you will not.
Simply.
And this has
So for you, you're saying, you know, NRM. NRM didn't, these things didn't start yesterday.
They did not.
They have been around.
They have been here.
As long as we have an objective of doing this program in the morning, let's not again discuss how the vehicle will go to one. Because the immediate thing is to have the program.
How the vehicle does not reverse.
For us,
we want the program.
Because we are in a problem.
Yes.
I don't know why some people are failing to realize that some people think this is someone else's shouri.
Exactly.
That's why we are thinking of this one hasn't come, this one is. We rather not have it.
Because we shall have more details of that. we will have more discussion on that issue. But remember, also, Cabinet approved 5 slots for the elderly.
You're the elderly.
No.
No, I'm just older than
I said elder. I didn't say elder.
Oana, let me start with Lynn, actually, on this issue. Because when I start with Oana...
So he's also an elder.
When I start with Oana...
And his young brother also calls him elder.
When I start with the one on this issue of the 5 slots for the elderly, they may think that
I have...
Yes.
Lynn, what is your view of having 90% of the cabinet full of elderly people. Elderly people. And their chairman of the cabinet is also elderly. Mm-hmm. They are also creating five other seats for other elderly. What is your view? Is it actually necessary?
No, it's absolutely not necessary. It's not necessary at all because what's their agenda? What do they want to achieve? Which elderly person is going to be
don't
in
point
there?
At me.
I am not pointing at you, Owana. I don't see the logic here. Mm. If they're just, you know, saying, okay, fine, it's an inclusive, we're trying to, you know, have people come in, the elders, you know, so they need to have a voice, blah, blah, blah.
We have the youth, we have the army, we have the people with disability.
Is it a special interest group? Is it under we're just saying, okay, fine, these are part of the community, they need to hear, to have a say here and there. I don't see the logic behind these five seats. Okay, fine, if why not one? Why five?
Why not ten?
Mm. You see? So it is something I totally disagree with because we already, like you said, we already have old
elderly
people.
Elderly people in parliament.
They themselves mentioned it. Members of parliament said, we already have older people in parliament. What is going on? What are they not doing? Or what? How can...
And they are elderly that may not be also represented, like the Chirunda Chivejinjas. Their age is a bit there. And you may have an elderly person who is representing them and is 60 years.
Somebody
and for them, they are close to 100.
That all they need is sage. And but they don't need
all they need is relief and also money.
If the government needs to get to the elderly, can they not create extra seats because our parliament is congested and we're not going to receive?
Before I go to Nicholas, let me pick a comment from Geoffrey Owana,
the elder of the panel,
the elder of the panel, and the elder of one of the elders of this fraternity in this country. What do you think? Will you
frowning?
Be actually? Will
you?
No,
when you are old, even when you are smiling, people think you are frowning. For hours.
What is your view actually on the move by cabinet?
I don't like it at all. The only thing I can laugh about with it is because there has been a tendency among you young people to think that to be young is also a profession.
Yes.
Uh-huh. And that we. Now it comes as a rude reminder for you to be told that we are also around.
Yes.
Beyond that, I don't see any value. And I don't like it. And if there was a way of torpedoing it, I would assist in torpedoing it. There was a proposal to create... Was it something called the Senate?
For the elderly people. For the elders. For senior citizens.
But for people who have seen a few things and they are not anxious for, you know.
For cash.
Maybe that one. But this one is an exercise in redundancy. This one. What are we trying to say? That we need some five people to say that. To say what? By the way, enlighten me. Who qualifies to be?
Elder.
No, there are two different issues. The elderly and the elder.
I want to learn. Now there's even elder and elderly. So at what age do we become elderly?
No. Mm-hmm. What I think is that the elderly...
You think the law must be clear.
Yeah.
There must be. Of course, it has not been approved by Parliament. These are the same questions that are going
to be, you
know. Of course,
it's
ambiguous. These are questions that are going to be, asked. What I'm saying is that, is there relevancy having...
Let me warn you, all of you.
Okay.
Because you are here pointing at me. I said, I was once like you, you will become like me.
And we are not so sure whether we will become like
there is also the chance of not getting there
to where you are.
So that's why
the issue is, I think we are not busy.
Yes.
Because if now we are creating new slots as if there is an urgent problem among the elderly that now no one speaks for us. My senior, Kirunda, is about 85. You know, Ali is inching there. There are many.
The president.
There are many. The president comes immediately below the
Rugunda, the vice president.
So there is no shortage of elderly.
In the parliament.
In parliament. Or even anywhere. Now, yeah, I'm on this panel. I'm on this panel.
Yes.
Eh? And don't joke with me, I even resemble the MOD.
Nicholas.
So we must torpedo that thing. Let us make a resolution here. Mm. As this panel. I think this panel is important.
It can constitute itself in a...
Parliament should do, sit down urgently and save itself from further embarrassment by rejecting the cabinet thing. It's not too late.
Mm-hmm.
We can do other things, but
and ignore it.
Then we are going to. I don't know how they will campaign. First of all, I hear.
Nicholas, what are your views?
I think one of, like all the other panelists have said, I think one of the most interesting proposals in that is that actually you do not have to be an elderly to represent the elders. Unlike the other special interest groups, for example, the youth MPs, for the five youth MPs, you must not be above 29 years, you get it. For the district women MPs, you must strictly be a woman. For the army representative, you must be a serving officer, you get it. For the people with disabilities, you must adduce evidence that you have a disability, you get it. But for the elders, so far so good, what is on the table is that, well, if Wasaja can convince the elderly or the owners that I can articulate your issues in the parliament, Wasaja can represent them. So now that creates an ambiguity. But most importantly is, what did the framers of the constitution envision when they talked about affirmative action? The way it was described is that these should be marginalized groups, you get it, at the time there was an issue of women emancipation. That's how district woman MPs come in place. However, actually the constitution even goes ahead and says every after 10 years this constitution should be reviewed to find out whether these special interest groups no longer continue to suit the purpose for which they were created.
Mm.
This has not been done. And you're creating five new slots, you get it, for the elderly. But also the other thing is, if you have, like when I said, a Moses Sali or a Chirunda Chivejinja or a Sekandi who sits in parliament, or any other person that cannot ably articulate issues of the elderly, then you are as good as not being in parliament already. You get it. Mm. So it's not going to make any difference you having someone who is of advanced age, you get it. I mean, imagine a senior citizen like Rhoda Kalema running around Buganda that they want to represent Central.
Rhoda said,
it's unnecessary. It's diversion.
Where was the problem for the minister, or rather for the cabinet, to say, okay, let's create five seats for the president to nominate about a few elders to come in parliament?
Well, like it was in the NRC.
Yes,
but just like
it is in other parliaments, where you find presidents have special nominees who are sent to parliament to represent the interests of whom we would have called vulnerable groups.
Mubarak, the challenge we are having in this country is that Uganda is overly represented,
yet
there is very little value for money in that over-representation.
Owana, why would you shoot
it
down?
We have only about 3 million elective posts in Uganda.
Did you just say only?
Yes.
And you know how many?
That a tenth of Ugandans are elected leaders.
And they are leaders.
You get it.
How,
I wrote about a study, I think, late last year that was done by SEDU. And apart from agriculture as an entity, the other largest employing profession in Uganda is elective politics. Mm. You get it. Right. So the question is, do these elected leaders deliver services?
There was a ministry.
Do they represent
there was a ministry
the
for
do they articulate
in the gender
in the
ministry of gender,
yeah,
labor
this,
and social
this,
development?
This particular term
was
not
scrapped
filled.
Off.
No, it's
now,
still there, but it wasn't.
It is
filled, this particular term.
What is now the essence of removing the minister and then creating five.
The minister, the post is vacant.
It's just there.
You wait.
You might feel it.
I compare this to the other redundancy. No.
Do they add value to this house?
They don't. No, look at this house.
The decision
already
we made to that prisoners will also vote. It is the same way I look at this thing of
Eleanor. This ambiguous thing.
Yes. It's
and how do we get out of this? Because we
how
seem to be in a catch
but
22.
But we got there somehow. This is not
but let me tell you. Let me tell you how we get out of this. If it is not approved in this term, you are a citizen with the right to vote. Vote the right member of parliament
why
to make the right
need,
decision on that particular decision.
As we are winding up, why the need to see importance in the elderly when it is just barely months when you had just scrapped off age limit? Are you just trying to attach importance to the advanced aged people?
Look at this young man. When we removed the age limit, we did not remove age.
Yes. I hear
age remained.
Nicholas, are you not trying to see someone trying to attach importance to the elderly people?
I think that someone you're talking about has of late surrounded themselves with a lot of young people and they feel lonely. And you know, when Owana moves out of this place after having a whole hour's conversation with us, would want to look for someone within his age so that they do you get it.
So in other words, we all agree that, and remember, there is no actually age limit. Even if you are 105 years, you are allowed to come and represent people in parliament.
No, you see where you might go wrong. You look closely during these sessions of parliament, like budget. You'll be surprised to find that Kirunda never sleeps. And you see a person whose name I won't mention.
Owana is insinuating. Owana is.
You make a mistake of assuming that because someone is 105, but this fellow of 30 will shock you.
Are you not seeing the same issue? Are you not seeing the same issue?
Don't you see this candidate who says that the president fears rallies because he will not be able to traverse?
What
is
for
him?
Yes.
My problem is
the president of this country is the PE.
Having the elderly in parliament, and then
that was pun intended.
Some of them might not be able to make, you know, may not come up with solutions to whatever they are discussing.
And Owana's submission, trying to smuggle in something that the elderly, some elderly are as very much important as of now than very young people.
You see,
we have to actually round up this because we can discuss this for an entire day because we have an elder here who is not yet an elderly. But of course, we shall be discussing that. Even you can join us on our social media platforms to continue submitting.
Permit me warning.
Again.
At 11.
Yes.
I and Jagenda Semakula are carrying our petition to parliament.
Over what?
Over preventing Makui and others from renaming the streets in Kampala.
But
that,
we are not
the discussion.
We shall have that
over
discussion.
Of course, thank you so much for having this discussion. We are coming back with
Jimmy all should be crucified.